Hello, this is Scary Scars Shared, in which real project managers share what they have learned from their most challenging project management experiences with me, Ken BurrelI. If you're new here, you might want to consider subscribing to the video channel or the podcast. Today, I'm delighted to be joined by Stuart Taylor, who's going to share his project management experiences with us. Stuart, can you start by giving us a flavour of your background and how you got into project management?
Yes, sure. I've been involved in project management for well over a decade now. I've worked as a project management professional as either a project manager, a PMO, or project or portfolio assurance in a kind of rotating pattern over that time. So I've worked across multiple industries from my first proper project management environment was in a local council, then to NHS, then to banking, and then from there to fintech, retail, and currently insurance. Fairly recently, in the last couple of years, I set up a YouTube channel to share my insights and my opinions and views about project management. And it's been a little bit popular. It's enabled me to meet some interesting people, including you, Ken. And I'll say that's probably been the one of the biggest benefits of it is the amount of people that I've met who really want to share something with the community. So thank you for what you're doing, Ken, and for sharing your stories and your expertise as well, because, you know, I don't know if you get a lot of people coming to you and telling you directly, but it is useful. It's very helpful, especially your book. You know, I know you don't plug very often, so I thought I'd mention it, your book.
I don't plug it, so thank you for the opportunity. Yes, Stuart's referring to my book, Learning Lessons from Projects, which is available from Amazon. Okay, thank you very much for that, Stuart. That's good to know. And your YouTube channel, lots of high quality videos on there, very useful to people, particularly those starting out in project management. Okay, so looking back over your project management career, can you give me an example of a scar, so something that's gone wrong on a project that you were managing and how you recovered from it?
Well, I don't know if I've actually recovered from it yet. I guess really, one of the projects that went wrong that I feel still to this day quite bad about was one of my earliest ones in my career. I'd just moved from working in local council to working for NHS, and the whole idea of it was to elevate year on year the patient experience as measured through various patient surveys, stories, and all these other sources we were pulling together into this giant data warehouse. And the idea was to elevate patient experience by 1% every year.
Right.
What happened though, I was a little bit naive, I guess. It was my first project where the reins had been taken off and I was just going for it. And I was still a little bit naive in the sense that I'd done the Prince 2 qualification and kind of still assumed everyone else in the world operated in projects using these kind of principles. And what happened was an external event that we really should have seen coming. So the government changed. There was a general election and the Conservative Lib Dem coalition came into power.
Yep.
They had announced well in advance, it had been in their manifesto for a long time, they were going to make significant changes to how the NHS worked. This project was based around the trusts that existed, creating this data to support people who were being serviced by the trust. They got rid of the trusts and the entire funding model changed. I'm not going to bore you with a whole bunch of health history, but basically the business case went away. The project had no real reason to continue based on its original premise. And what I did, and what I regret, was I accepted that.
Right.
So I managed to transfer the information that I had gathered and the database that had been created in a prototype to a different trust that was going to be kept after these changes happened. So the learning was still going to be used, but it was equivalent to me chucking it over the fence as, you know, the project was closing. That was not part of the objective of the project. So it was something I took on my own initiative, but I should have done more than that because this was an incredibly valuable tool. And right. What it demonstrated, from pulling all this data together, we could see very effective early warning indicators of when there was going to be a quality issue in a hospital. So really what I should have done looking back was to think differently and start to make bridges with people, because I wasn't going to move across to a different trust. You know, I was going to go and do something else. I was going to go and work on a different project.
Yeah.
What I should have done then is use the relationships that I'd built and share that information and that tool more widely, so more people could have benefited from it. Possibly done a little roadshow, gone around a few trusts and showed them,
right,
this is a useful prototype. You can actually make use of this. And it's fairly easy to do if you invest a little bit of time and effort. And that's my big regret, that I didn't go the extra mile. What bothers me about it is you can have all sorts of projects where you don't go the extra mile and your company's not so profitable, or you can not go the extra mile and maybe something you're building isn't built to last. But when you look back and you think, I didn't go the extra mile and patients' lives were impacted.
Yeah.
That's my big regret.
So just to recap then, you have a project and as a result of a government change, the business case was no longer viable in that context. But what you'd managed to produce within the project up to the point where it was closed still had some value in it. But unfortunately, that value was lost.
Pretty much. I mean, the product would have still been useful to anybody.
Yeah.
But the organization funding it and who would have owned it wouldn't exist a year later.
So what could you have done as an alternative to what did happen?
Everyone else in the organization at that point started to work on their networks and trying to get themselves positioned, because they knew that when the new model was going to come across, the people who were still in the primary care trusts would have transferred across in some way. They might have had a different title, they might have had a change in salary or circumstances or location, but they still needed the expertise to move across. So people started positioning themselves to do that.
Right.
What I should have done is something similar. I should have actually made those connections, reached out to that network, not to position myself for a role there because it wasn't something I was interested in doing, but to position something for this tool to be used,
yeah,
so it could continue to be useful, and that the benefits that were expected from the business case, which wouldn't now be realized by the funding organization, could instead be realized by multiple other organizations,
yeah,
with a,
yeah,
benefit to patients, which is what we're all supposed to really care about when we're, yeah, working, yeah, in NHS.
So looking back on that then, what would you advise other people to do if they find themselves in a similar situation, or better still, to avoid arriving in that sort of situation?
Well, there's no way to avoid the situation entirely. You could say that many projects have on their risk registers things that are outside of their control. Something may happen externally that will stop this project happening, and most people, yep, will, yep, dismiss that as a worry rather than a risk. But in this circumstance, at the time of a general election where there was an unpopular government ready to be voted, yep, out, what I should have done is look at this external factor and say, okay, there's a risk this is coming along. There's a risk it's going to be realised. They're going to change the way the NHS works. And it's not, you know, a remote possibility. It's a significant possibility.
Yeah.
And then start factoring around contingency plans on what, yeah, to do with these tools. Whether I would have been supported in that by the senior management, who it probably wasn't their top priority, to be honest,
no,
how somebody else would use this tool that we'd created. Even though it wasn't their priority, I could have made it my priority. But you know what? It could benefit the people of many other counties. Even if it's benefits that can't be realised by you, you'd want them to be realised somewhere. So that's my mistake. That was where I fell short. That's why it's my regret.
Stuart, thank you for sharing your experiences with us. Having heard about Stuart's experience, what can you learn from it? What will you do differently in your projects as a result? If you enjoyed this interview, you might want to consider subscribing to the video channel or the podcast. If you'd like to receive free hints and tips, sign up to our semi-regular newsletter. If you'd like to share one of your scars, then get in touch. And in the meantime, until the next time, thanks for listening.